Today on Christian World News, the U.S. renews its commitment to Afghanistan. Our military reporter tells us about the troops and their faith, as well as how Christians can help meet the needs of the Afghan people. Plus, teaching Israelis about the biblical history of their nation, why some say it amounts to starting a religious war. And driven from their homeland, Burmese refugees find sanctuary in neighboring Thailand. They're also finding faith in Jesus Christ. And welcome everybody to Christian World News. I'm George Thomas. My colleague Wendy Griffith is on assignment. We begin in our nation's capital, where President Obama and Afghan President Hamid Karzai met at the White House this week, where they renewed their commitment to fight terrorists. White House correspondent David Brody explains what this means for the ongoing war in Afghanistan.
Afghan President Hamid Karzai and President Obama met in the Oval Office, smiled during a joint news conference, and shook hands, reaffirming their commitment as strong allies. A far cry from the tension of the past few months, filled with wrangling about how the 9-year-long war should be managed. One thing both governments do agree on, the war will likely get worse before it gets better.
One thing that I've tried to emphasize is the fact that there's going to be some hard fighting over the next several months.
That will mean more sacrifices, like the ones President Karzai faced as he visited wounded American troops.
It was a very difficult moment for me, Mr. President. To meet with a young man, very, very young man, who had lost two arms and legs. It was heart-rending.
The military strategy remains focused on releasing areas from Taliban control, and President Obama is still committed to the goal of starting to draw down forces in July 2011. That has some analysts concerned.
My fear here is that the Afghan army is not strong enough to take over, and I believe that the deadline that we've created for ourselves for withdrawal is an arbitrary date. Withdrawal should be based on what we're seeing on the ground at the time that we propose to withdraw. Trying to stick to a hard deadline, I think, will ultimately undermine the mission.
But President Karzai shares in the commitment that Afghan forces will be ready by then to take over. David Brody, CBN News, Washington.
CBN military correspondent Chuck Holton recently returned from 6 weeks in Afghanistan, where he was embedded with some special operations unit. Wendy talked with Chuck about his experiences, specifically the faith of our troops and the needs of the Afghan people.
Chuck, we know Afghanistan, of course, is mostly Muslim country. Are there any Christians there?
There are so few Christians in Afghanistan that the vast majority of people that live there have never even seen or met a Christian, either knowingly or unknowingly.
Now, you've been there several times. Do you ever get an opportunity to share your faith in Jesus Christ with the Afghanis?
I do. As a matter of fact, it's difficult. You know, you have to be very sensitive about that, especially if you're traveling with the military, because the military is not allowed to proselytize, and, for good reason. That's not what they're there for. But this last trip I was there, just went to get a bowl of cereal one night in the chow hall and ran into an Afghan interpreter, and he had never been outside of the country. He'd grown up in Afghanistan, and he said he had never met a Christian until the Americans came over in the invasion. And a Canadian guy had given him a Bible, and he started asking me questions about it and saying, I've been trying to read it, but I don't understand it. Can you explain it to me? And so I had a chance, just over a bowl of cereal one night, to explain the gospel to an Afghan Muslim.
Now, of course, you spent a lot of time with the troops there. And how important is their faith to them when you talk to them?
You know, I was there on Easter Sunday this year, and I was just really gratified to see how every chapel on the post that I was at was just packed out. I was in Kandahar, where there are over 20,000 troops, and it was obviously very important and very special day to them.
Yeah.
What I hear talking to our troops is that maybe it wasn't as important to them before they got there. But in coming to Afghanistan and in, so to speak, facing their mortality on a daily basis, it gets them thinking, and it really gets a lot of them moving that direction in their faith. And a lot of them have said, I'm very glad for my deployment to Afghanistan or Iraq, because that was really the turning point in my faith.
Well, we know, of course, that God's heart is for the Muslim people. Chuck, how can we be praying for Afghanistan right now?
You know, the vast majority of people in Afghanistan live pretty much like they did 1,500 years ago. But there's a lot of just abject poverty in Afghanistan. But even greater than their physical poverty is their spiritual poverty. Most places you go, there's nothing else to read except the Quran. And they have, it's so gut-wrenching to me to go to some of these villages up in the mountains where there probably has never been a Westerner before, where they, you know, not only don't have roads or running water or electricity, but they don't have access to any other options. And I just, you know, it hurts my heart to think that these beautiful Afghan children will grow up and never even get to hear the name of Jesus.
Wow.
And so I would pray that something in this world chain of events that has brought America to Afghanistan for 10 years will change the hearts of the Afghan people. And you know, that's really the only way that, we can bring peace there, because you're not gonna bring peace by the sword. You only bring peace through love.
Terrific. And if you'd like to learn more about Afghanistan, its people, or even just figure out how to pray more effectively for the troops there, you can go to our website at cwnews.org. Yes, Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu is using the Bible to defend the Jewish state's claim to Jerusalem. Netanyahu told Parliament that Jerusalem's alternative Hebrew name, Zion, appears in the Old Testament 850 times. Netanyahu also noted the city is mentioned 142 times in the New Testament. He then pointed out that Jerusalem is nowhere mentioned in the Muslim holy book, the Quran. Israel wants its young people to learn more about the country's biblical and Jewish history. In fact, so many Israeli youth know very little about this heritage. And now some Palestinians are working to make it harder by trying to erase Israel's connection to its roots. Our man Chris Mitchell has more from Jerusalem.
Many of Israel's enemies are trying to rewrite Jewish history, denying the Holocaust, and pretending thousands of years of Jewish connection to this land didn't exist. And sadly, National Infrastructure Minister Uzi Landau says many Israeli youngsters don't even know their own history.
Over the past few decades here in Israel, we have neglected that. And we haven't really told the story of our people, of our heritage.
I guess most of the children doesn't think history is really important. They are very busy on the Facebook.
Israel's answer to this is the Heritage Project. It's designed to build up the country's youth with an understanding of their biblical and national legacy.
We should know our case. We should be convinced on it, and we should be prepared to defend it.
And it doesn't come without a fight. Palestinians rioted after Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu added two biblical sites in the West Bank, Biblical Judea, to the heritage list. Then the Obama administration sharply criticized the Israelis for claiming the biblical sites as their own.
The Cave of the Patriarchs here in Hebron is one of those places. The biblical forefathers Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob and their wives are buried in this shrine. But the Islamic authorities say the Jews have no history here.
Abraham, he never was a Jew. He was a Muslim, pure Muslim according to the Quran.
The cave is divided into a mosque and a synagogue, so each faith has a place to pray. Israel says its plans would improve the site for Muslims and Jews alike. That doesn't work for the head of the Islamic authorities in Hebron, who says this site is holy only to Muslims.
It's a pure Muslim holy place, and there is no right for non-Muslims to be here or to pray here. And I am against the presence of the Jews even in the Old City.
CBN News asked young Israelis about Hebron.
I don't really think it's very important right now.
No?
It's not really history. I don't think about that like this.
I think the situation there is very difficult, and there are problems on both sides, and for that reason I don't like to visit.
Hebron? I know it's a city, but I don't know anything about it.
It's part of our country. I think that all the people should come there and see the historic place. It's very important to us.
Even though biblical history shows the Jews were the first to lay claim to the cave, Area resident Eliakim Haetzni says the place should be open to all.
So one should expect that this should be the meeting place of those three religions, the place where they embrace.
The other location, Rachel's tomb, is located in the West Bank town of Bethlehem. Israeli-Palestinian agreements guarantee freedom of access and worship at both sites. But Palestinian Authority President Mahmoud Abbas said naming the sites as part of Israel's heritage could spark a religious war. Netanyahu spokesman Mark Regev says the Palestinian reaction is not conducive to peace.
To deny the importance of these sites to the Jewish people, to Jewish civilization, is to deny my people's history.
But Landau points out archaeology proves that Jewish roots are more than 2,000 years deeper than Muslim roots. Now, more than $100 million will rehabilitate some 150 biblical and archaeological, as well as modern Jewish sites. Those sites include Qumran, where the Dead Sea Scrolls were found, Tel Megiddo, which overlooks the valley where many scholars believe the nations will gather for the Battle of Armageddon, and Caesarea, where Pontius Pilate ruled and Cornelius, the first non-Jew, came to believe in Jesus.
I think it's good for those in the West who have forgotten what their fathers who knew the Bible knew, that they should come here and learn the story of the Holy Land.
Landau said it's important for Israelis and all Westerners to know their own heritage and be prepared to defend it. 14-year-old Shira agreed.
We can't live here without knowing the past.
Chris Mitchell, CBN News, Hebron.
Coming up, war and persecution drove them from their homeland. Now these former Buddhists are finding faith in Jesus Christ.
CWNews.org, your constant news source on the World Wide Web. Find daily updates on the global church. Watch the weekly broadcast.
Three former presidents come together to honor the life and ministry.
Also available in podcast. The in-depth insights into our reporter blogs.
Taliban kidnapped at least 18 South Korean Christians.
Your online news source for complete coverage of the global church.
Thanks, Pete. Hi, I'm Terry Musin. We receive so many letters and emails from viewers who say their day just isn't the same if they don't see the 700 Club. That's why I'm so excited to tell you that you'll never have to miss another show. The 700 Club's here for you every Monday through Friday with stories of hope and encouragement, practical information to make your life better, and insight you need to make sense of what's going on in the world. It's never been easier to see the 700 Club. Even if breaking news interrupts us, you can still watch the show. Call this number or go to CBN.com to get this list of all the different channels in your area where you can see the 700 Club. With the 700 Club airing on so many channels, you can choose the one that's best for you. So remember, no matter what happens, whether it's big or small, you can always see the 700 Club.
Call or log on to CBN.com for this important information.
Daddy?
Yeah, buddy?
How many nickels are in a dollar?
There are 20 nickels in a dollar.
How do birds fly? Does milk really make my bones stronger?
Yeah.
Daddy, when we die, will we go to heaven?
Do you have the answer to life's biggest question? Call the 700 Club. We'll help you find answers to the important questions life brings your way.
Well, a lot of political drama in Britain this week. Conservatives and Liberal Democrats joined forces to create the country's first coalition government since World War II. Conservative David Cameron replaced Prime Minister Gordon Brown. At 43 years old, Cameron is Britain's youngest Prime Minister in almost 200 years. Some of his past comments gave insight into his faith. He says he has a classic Anglican background and adds, "I'm a Christian. I go to church. I believe in God, but I do not have a direct line." He also said that while organized religion has its faults, the Church of England and other churches do play a very important role in society. Turning now to a story about religious freedom in China. Christian human rights attorney Gao Xisheng has disappeared again. Gao surfaced a few weeks ago after months in government custody. Human rights watchers believe he was allowed to contact relatives to prove that he is still alive. Now he has once again gone missing and presumed to be in the custody of the government. Gordon Chang is a columnist for Forbes.com who lived in China for two decades. He told us that Gao is part of a larger crackdown against attorneys in China.
Lawyers have defended Christians. They've defended all sorts of oppressed people in Chinese society. And that's why Gao Xisheng, the famous human rights lawyer, was disappeared twice now in the last 13, 14 months because the Chinese government wants to cripple any sort of people coming together, even if it's just to pray to God. And Gao, who is one of the most famous of them, did represent underground Christians. But, you know, for all of these human rights lawyers, they have undergone just very, very difficult times, especially in the last 7 to 8 months, where their licenses to practice law have been stripped away. They've been imprisoned. In Gao's case, they've been tortured. This is an ongoing campaign to target lawyers so that people have no one to represent them in society.
To learn how you can speak up for Gao and others like him, you can visit our website at cwnews.org. On the subject of human rights abuses and constant, in one place, constant fighting and poverty are forcing tens of thousands of people to flee the Asian nation of Burma, also known as Myanmar. Many of those folks there have sought refuge in neighboring Thailand. Most of these illegal migrants live a life of uncertainty, but many have found sanctuary and lasting peace. CBN Asia correspondent Lucille Talusan reports from Burma.
For more than two decades, Thailand has played host to refugees from Burma, also known as Myanmar. The Burmese fled their country because of poor living conditions and gross human rights abuses they suffered at the hands of the government.
More than 3 million Burmese are now living in different parts of Thailand. Many of them have found a new home here, and there are those who have found a new faith.
Sai Min was 15 when he joined a rebel group in Burma.
Our family became very poor after my father, who was a soldier, lost his legs while fighting, and eventually he also lost his job. We had no money to buy food. I only reached second grade in school. When I became a teenager, I had no direction in life, and so I joined my friends to go to the mountains and fight against the military.
After 3 years, Sai Min was tired of fighting. He crossed the border to Thailand to find a job. But like most illegal migrants, he was sold into servitude. A fisherman paid an agent $300 for Sai Min. But he had to work off twice that amount to buy his freedom.
It was very difficult, but here I have a chance to find a job and have a better life.
Sai Min was a Buddhist, but in 2007 found new life when a friend brought him to the Myanmar Christian Assembly. Here, Burmese refugees surrender their lives to Jesus and are transformed. Like Sai Min, these former Buddhists are baptized into the Christian faith after learning about God's love for them.
While we were praying, I saw in a vision the statue of Buddha collapsed, and I saw Jesus standing before me. He said, "I am the Lord above all gods and idols. I used to be a Buddhist, but now I worship Jesus Christ in my life."
Everyone has a personal testimony that God is alive. Jesus is alive first. The Holy Spirit convinced them. And then they accepted Jesus Christ as their personal savior.
Pastor Zomin says their church is training its members to be evangelists and missionaries.
They will go back home one day when the country is open. They become missionaries to their own homes and their own villages.
I like to share my family how Jesus has changed me. Before, I used to drink and do drugs, but all that stopped when I surrendered my life to Jesus. I am very happy now. And I want my family to be happy too.
Lucille Talusan, CBN News, Bangkok.
Thank you, Lucille. Well, coming up, these prisoners may be locked up in prison, but as you can see, their voices are traveling through the airwaves, and they're carrying the message of Christ.
It's the one thing news viewers can agree on.
They want change.
Now, the world's leading Christian news organization brings you national, international news and analysis throughout the day. Mornings, the busy lunch hour, late afternoon, and evenings. It's news with a Christian perspective whenever you want it. Available on the web 24/7 at cbnnews.com.
You and I live in a visible world, yet there is at work all around us an invisible kingdom of unlimited goodness and power. In the Bible, Jesus Christ has given us fundamental kingdom principles that are as valid in our world today as the law of gravity. These principles can overcome every obstacle or circumstance we encounter and guarantee our success.
Taken from his national bestseller, The Secret Kingdom, this latest DVD by Pat Robertson reveals how God's kingdom works, principles that produce exceptional growth and development, unchanging keys that build success in business, finances, health, relationships, and much more.
You can reach from a world of impossibilities into a realm of limitless possibility and power.
The Secret Kingdom by Pat Robertson. Available now.
As co-host of the 700 Club, I see incredible stories of God's faithfulness to our viewers every day. It builds our faith to see what God is doing in people's lives. Perhaps you've seen a miracle in your finances. We'd like to share your story with others so that they too can be encouraged. Please call 1-800-759-0700 or log on to cbn.com. We want to hear from you. Your life can inspire others.
You know, when Riley Serrano suddenly found himself in prison, he thought back to his experience as a radio announcer. He hoped that perhaps his misfortune could be turned into a blessing. Well, with the help of the Spanish 700 Club Ministry, that's exactly what happened. And his story is right now coming from Santa Ana Penitentiary in El Salvador.
Every day, well-known radio announcer Riley Serrano begins his shift with a greeting for his captive audience.
Hello, this is Riley Serrano. Stay tuned for some special programming this morning.
His is an unusual challenge, to match a truly unusual radio station.
Transmitting live here in the Western Penitentiary of Santa Ana.
Radio Esperanza, or Radio Hope, is the first closed-circuit radio station in Central America operating within a prison, whose director, besides being a radio professional, is also an inmate.
That motivates us to reach a group of more than 600 inmates with positive messages. Not only in the music, but also in what we say. We share with all those people who need hope. We're keeping you company with some very special programs.
Radio speakers located throughout the prison draw a large audience of inmates who gladly listen to the 10 hours of daily programming, which includes Christian and popular music, motivational messages, helpful information, news, and interviews.
Adulteries, fornication, blasphemies. So the greatest problem of a human heart is located precisely in the center of his heart, which is the source that reveals all that he is.
The 700 Club has been doing counseling and evangelism in this prison since 1993. The ministry played a major role in providing equipment for the prison radio station.
The reaction is positive, and people are waiting to see what time the preaching begins and when they're putting on praise music to worship the name of the Lord Jesus Christ.
Many prisoners testify about how the radio has transformed their lives and the lives of their fellow prisoners.
Many times, people cannot stand the pressures of jail. Some even decide to hang themselves. You see many things, and the only path is to seek God and to know that He is the only one who can help us.
That message was powerful enough to change the Western Penitentiary from one of the most violent prisons in El Salvador into one of the most peaceful.
The level of stress has fallen, and we feel that the treatment programs from the technical team are strengthened by the positive subjects presented there.
This gives the team of radio announcers and technicians, all prison inmates, a great sense of satisfaction.
It feels good to help. I can teach others to survive in life and not to fall into the mistake of returning here.
And it helps, says Radio Esperanza's director, that there's no competition.
They can't unplug you or change the dial. They have to listen to you.
Stan Jeter, CBN News.
I'm Gary Haven, founder and CEO of Curves. I first read The Secret Kingdom. It appeared at a time where I had just hit rock bottom. The Secret Kingdom played a big part in Curve's success. It taught us those basic biblical principles that, if applied, allowed God to bless us. Today, we're the ninth largest of any franchise company. We do business in 80 countries. We're the largest fitness franchise in America, in Canada, in Japan, Brazil. It's been an amazing story. Had I not learned the principles in the Secret Kingdom, Diane and I would probably be in Harlingen, Texas, running two Curves, helping hundreds of women, but millions of women might still be suffering. This year, that company, along with all the franchisees, is a $2 billion a year company. And that's a miracle.
Ready on the set? Going to Dr. Robertson in 3, 2.
On December 3rd, 2009, Pat Robertson entered the studio to update his landmark work, The Secret Kingdom, to help people live abundant lives amid today's challenges.
I want to talk to you today about The Secret Kingdom. What is The Secret Kingdom?
The Secret Kingdom, Volume 1, available now.
Christian World News, your window to the global church. For stories of revival.
Another revival.
Persecution.
Relatives and fellow Christians mourn him.
First country over the international dateline.
I'm George Thomas in Baghdad, and coming up on the broadcast, an exclusive interview.
And the impact of Christian leaders. Watch Christian World News.
One man's journey halfway across the country is turning heads in every state he enters. Well, that's because he's carrying a 40-pound cross on his shoulder. That's right. Joshua Saharan says the Lord told him to walk across country and share the gospel with people. So he did. So far, he's traveled through 8 states and he's gotten some attention.
And if nothing else, you know, they see the cross and it's a reminder of Jesus for what he did for us all. And but yeah, plenty of people, you know, pull over and, you know, bless me and allow me to bless them and just, you know, speak of Jesus's love and his redemptive qualities and his salvation, that he came to save us all.
Wow, exciting. Well, we have taken you all around the world, from the Philippines to El Salvador. I hope you have enjoyed our broadcast this week, blessed by all the efforts of the team back here at CBN. We hope you've enjoyed this week and this week's broadcast. We will see you right here next week. From all of us, goodbye and God bless.